Now this morning, we haven't done our scripture reading. What I'm going to do is in a moment, I'm going to open in prayer. And I'm going to be, this morning, we're going to be looking again at the Lord's Prayer, really verse 11 of Matthew 6, primarily. If you have a Bible, we'd invite you to turn to Matthew 6. If you don't, there's one in front of you. And instead of our reading together this morning, what we're going to do is, when I pray, I'm going to do something a little more traditional. And that is, at the end of the prayer, I'm going to invite you to join with me to pray as our Lord taught us to pray, and together pray the Lord's Prayer out loud. And we are going to have the words up on the screen. And for those of us who have not memorized it, it's a good thing to read it. It's a great thing to memorize, to know. Because again, if God has given it to us as an outline, if we're aware of it, we can use it. If we're not aware of it, if we don't know it, it's kind of hard to use it. And so let me begin with a word of prayer, and then again, as we end up, I'll invite you to join me, and I will invite you to join in praying together these words from the Lord's Prayer. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for the chance that we have to come together, Father, and to be able to seek after you, Father, to celebrate what you're doing. Father, to be able to come in the context of a week and to realize that we are bringing so many requests to you. But Father, at the same time, to be able to see so many answers to prayer. Father, thank you that we can come now and we can dive into your word. Thank you that you have given us guidelines that help us to know how we're to relate to you, how we're to approach you even in prayer. Father, thank you for the things that you teach me. And Father, I pray that you get me out of the way. And Father, that you help me to now just be a vehicle to communicate through your spirit the truths that you want us all to learn. Father, help us to hear your heart. And now we pray together as our Lord has taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. May God bless his word. Let's come together. Now, I want to tell you, as we look at this, I'm going to start by going a little different direction. I was thinking about how, you know, a lot of times you have classic children's books, and we're aware of these books, and every once in a while they try to make it into a movie, and usually it doesn't go very well, and sometimes the classic book becomes a movie that becomes a classic movie as well. And an example of that is the 1970 version of Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. And many of us have seen that. It's a classic movie. And amongst that story, you have five children we get introduced to. And four of the five kids are kind of dysfunctional kids. And you have, you know, wonderful examples of terrible parenting and the dysfunctional kids that it brings about. And probably the worst example of bad parenting and the really rotten kid is a little girl named Rybka Salt and her overindulgent dad. And just here's a little picture of this little girl.
I wanted to be the first to find a golden ticket, Daddy.
I know, Angel. We're doing the best we can. I've got every girl on the bleeding staff hunting for you.
All right, where is it? Why haven't they found it?
Veruca, sweetheart, I'm not a magician. Give me time.
I want it now. What's the matter with those twats down there?
For 5 days now, the entire flipping factory's been on the job. They haven't shelled a peanut in there since Monday. They've been shelling flaming chocolate bars from dawn to dusk.
Make them work nights.
Come along, you girls. Put a jerk in it, or you'll be out in your ears, every one of you. And listen to this. The first girl that finds a golden ticket gets a £1 bonus in her pay packet. What do you think of that?
They're not even trying. They don't want to find it. They're jealous of me.
Sweetheart, I can't push them no harder. 19,000 bars an hour they're shelling. 760,000 they've done so far.
You promised, Daddy. You promised I'd have it the very first day.
You're going to be very unpopular around here, Henry, if you don't deliver soon.
It breaks my heart, Henrietta. I hate to see her unhappy.
I won't talk to you ever again. You're a rotten, mean father. You'll never give me anything I want. And I won't go to school till I have it.
Veruca, sweetheart, angel. Now, there are only four tickets left in the whole world, and the whole ruddy world's hunting for them. What can I do?
I got it! I got it! It's a soul! Here it is! for that.
Aye. Happiness is what counts for children. Happiness and harmony.
Now you look at that, and we read that, and we say, okay, now we're talking about the Lord's Prayer, and we're talking about verse 11, and give us this day our daily bread, and the part that we're probably think about when we think of prayer, petition. And what in the world does this have to do with, you know, with the Lord's Prayer? Now, let me start by just throwing a couple thoughts out there, a couple questions. You know, for many of us, when we think of prayer, we think almost exclusively of telling God our needs, you know, of the whole concept of petition. And if we're honest, I think that many of us would admit that, you know, we often don't even pray that much when things are going well. It's not until we have some kind of crisis, some kind of need, some kind of concern in our life. Suddenly then, our prayer life goes way up. You know, we might even be almost non-existent, or it's, you know, our prayer life is praying before a meal or maybe a couple minutes before bed. But when we have that crisis, when somebody loses a job, when somebody gets sick, when the marriage seems to be at risk, suddenly we're praying all the time. And we're asking other people to pray, and we want everyone to pray for the request because suddenly God's very important to us. Now, while we would never say this about our prayers or about our relationship with God, here's the question. If the only time that we pray is when we need something, then isn't the extent of our relationship with God that we value that relationship just how much he can give us, what he can provide for us? And if we go to only him only when we have a need, aren't we telling God by our actions, you know, that I only value you for what you do for me, for who you are. We don't want a relationship beyond that. It isn't that important to us. And if we only pursue God when we want stuff for him, how are we that much different than Rybka? And we don't like to think of ourselves that way. Or here's a second question, even to build on that. Okay, when we pray, it's usually, again, about something we say it's important to us. And so we feel like, you know, we're telling God our needs and it is important. And then if God doesn't answer, if we don't see the answer in the time or way that we expect, it's often a crisis. Now, why do we experience that crisis? It's often a crisis because we feel like if we have come to God the right way, we've asked appropriately in prayer, and it's something that we believe is important, that we kind of expect God to answer. But is it right for us to expect that God would answer? See, here's the question. You know, we saw this clip, and we have a rotten child whose heart was spoiled by an overindulgent dad who gave in to every demand every time she told him what she thought she needed to be happy. Now, if we know that that's bad parenting on earth, why do we think that God would parent us that way spiritually so that every time we come to him and we tell him what we need, we expect he's going to give us what we ask? Now, again, we might say, well, wait a second, but that's about a chocolate bar, and my prayers are about things that really matter, or it's about things that are really important. But again, remember that a child, when they come to a parent, every time they come, it's because they believe that's what they need to make them happy. And is it possible that our perception is often more like that of a child, that that's what we think we need, but maybe God sees a perspective other than what we do? So if we look at this and we say, okay, well, it's possible that maybe we can understand the whole idea of petition, but we can come to God in the wrong way, that we could almost be the demanding child and we want God to be, you know, the parent that gives us everything. Well, no, that's not how we're supposed to pray. Then how are we to pray? And what does it mean to bring our request before God? When we look at this part of the prayer, we see that Jesus is teaching us that we should give us this day our daily bread. We should bring that request to God. But what is the invitation? It's an invitation ultimately to bring our needs before him. But why does he use these words? You know, why does he say, give us this day our daily bread? You know, because, you know, why doesn't he more use a more general term? You know, why doesn't he just say, you know, when you're coming, bring your needs before God? Or if Philippians 4, we're going to see in a minute, and it says, make every request before God. But he uses unusual wording especially for us that seems unusual. And I think it's especially unusual for us because we live in a prosperous country where most of us really don't worry about getting bread for the next day. I mean, the fact of the matter is bread is very abundant. We assume we're going to have bread. We might wonder what kind of meat we're going to put on the bread, but the fact of the matter is that something that we have in abundance. In fact, for most of us, you know, we're more worried about maybe having too many calories and not enough. Now, so why does he do this? What we've got to realize is that if we fixate just on give us this bread, then we miss the idea. Because Jesus is teaching us here a principle about prayer. The word bread includes all the basics that we need for life. What he's doing is he's teaching us to pray for our food, for our clothing, for our job, for our schooling, for our health, for the wisdom that we need each day, for everything that is necessary for us. What he's doing is that he moves from the lesser to the greater. In other words, what he's saying is that if you need to pray for your bread, if you need to pray for your general, just day-to-day sustenance, if you have to pray for the calories that you would eat, then think about things that maybe are more significant, that are harder to come by. And if you got to pray for bread, then you should be praying for everything. That's his point, is that we should have this attitude that acknowledges our dependence on God for everything. So we pray, give us this day our daily bread, because God is concerned about our practical needs and he wants us to come to them. That's the point that Jesus makes later in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 6. Look what he says. For the Gentiles seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Should we be concerned about our practical needs? Yes. But God is, and God's concerned, and he's going to provide. But he wants us to see beyond it. Now, when he teaches us, give us this day our daily bread, what he's teaching is that he does want us to come to him with our daily needs. He does want to bring our request before him. Another passage that I think teaches this wonderfully is in Philippians chapter 4. Look what Paul teaches about how we're to pray. Don't be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Now that's wonderful. What's it saying? You know, don't be anxious about anything. But in everything, every concern that we have, every worry that we have, every need that we perceive that we have, God wants us to bring it to him. It doesn't even say, well, test it and see if you feel good about it. No, he wants us to bring everything to him. And when we learn to properly do that, to bring every request to him in the context of prayer and supplication and thanksgiving, when we learn to do that, then what's the promise? That he'll give us a peace of God that surpasses understanding, that will guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus in any circumstance. So clearly the Bible teaches that we're openly to bring our needs and requests to God. But when we look at this, we've got to realize that we can't take what Jesus is teaching here in the Lord's Prayer in isolation. What we've seen is that in our study thus far of the Lord's Prayer is that Jesus is teaching us an outline of prayer. He's teaching us principles and how we're to approach God. And what we're seeing is that it all fits together. And you know what? There might be times that it's the crisis that drives us to prayer. There might be times that it's the need that drives us to prayer. We can't get focused just on there, because if we're going to understand what it means to come and bring our needs before God, we've got to do so. And again, the context of the whole thing. The request here, give us this day our daily bread, is in the middle of the Lord's Prayer. It's not like Jesus says, okay, when you pray, start with your requests and then continue on. He says, no, if you want to understand to pray, you might come and your awareness might be the need, but when you come, go through this outline, go through this process. Because what we've seen is that the Lord's Prayer is cumulative in nature, that Jesus gives us these different ideas and principles of prayer and they build on each other. And I've got to start from the foundation and I've got to build up, because I won't really understand what it means to properly pray, God, give me my daily bread, God, help meet my needs, unless I first built on the right foundation. And so what we're seeing is that there's a sense that if you see this, there's almost a sense there's a prerequisites to praying this request. Before I can really get to that point of saying, okay, God, give me this day my daily bread, God, here are my needs, here are my requests, there's certain things that I need to come first of all. And the first principle is at the core of everything that we understand about prayer is that Jesus teaches us that how do we approach God? The very first word, our Father. He's teaching us that prayer ultimately is, the primary purpose of prayer is about relationship. That God wants a relationship with us. And prayer isn't so that we can somehow tell him his needs because he didn't know it, and we need to explain it. And the whole purpose of prayer is that God wants a relationship with us. And he wants us to come to him as Father, understanding the nature of his love and the nature of relationship. And if we understand that, it changes us. It changes everything about prayer. But it's not only about relationship in general, but to understand then about what prayer is, we've got to go even deeper and understand something of the nature of the relationship. So when we come to the petitions that we bring before God, you know, give us this day our daily bread, we've got to realize not only are we coming to our Father, but what do we believe about the Father? Because as we've seen, the relationship that we have will define every interaction we have with people. It changes how we who we ask and how we ask. So for example, again, you know, we've used a lot of these examples. Let's say if we have a car, our car breaks down, right? And so suddenly our car breaks down. We don't go to a stranger and say, boy, my car broke down, can you give me a ride? You know, can you go buy me some gas? And no, we're uncomfortable doing that because we don't have a relationship with them. Now, we might go to a coworker and ask for that ride, especially if they're a friend. But if we do, we might apologize for putting them out. You know, I'm sorry to ask, and I'm sorry to, you know, but would you do this? And, well, I owe you. I owe you something. But if you're married, you just call your spouse and ask, you know, I need you to come pick me up from work today. Can you do that? And we ask, and we don't think anything of it because you have confidence of a relationship with them. And the relationship totally changes how you come and ask for things. Or, you know, if you have a teen and you're still living at home, you know, you think nothing not only of calling your parents and say, hey, the car broke down and can you come pick me up? You'll even add to that, and can you fix the car? You know, it's like we think nothing of asking those things because of the relationship. Now, this is what Jesus is teaching us when he says that when we come and pray our Father, we need to not only realize its relationship, but as we then come to that Father, we need to have confidence in the heart and love of our Heavenly Father, of knowing that we come to one who cares about us and not only wants to know us, but loves us. So we're not coming up to a stranger with whom we have no relationship, or we're not even coming to a ruler, to eternal God, to whom we have to prove our worth and say the right words and somehow try to impress him. Jesus teaches us that we're to come to God as Father, appealing to the fact that we have the closest possible relationship. And we have that relationship not based on what we do. It's based on acceptance of what Christ has done for us. See, it's not about religion where somehow you do these things and you earn God's favor. The Christian message is about us being unable to earn God's favor, but realizing that Jesus Christ came and died on the cross for our sins. And we have a relationship as we acknowledge our need and ask him to forgive us through Jesus. And suddenly through that, we're forgiven through Jesus. It's unconditional. It's acceptance based on grace. Now, if we understand that, it changes the way that we pray. See, one of the things that is, and again, we've used a lot of illustrations through this prayer that, you know, that what we've seen as we talk about Father, and I'll use a lot of illustrations about parent-child relationship. Because there are so many times that when you think about prayer and my relationship with God that I look at this and God says, okay, call me Father. And then as I realize my interactions with my young children especially, I see how God does the same thing to me and how my children react to me, and that's what I do with God. There have been countless times that I've thought or I've even said to my kids, you know, why don't you understand this? You know, why can't you just trust your dad? And as soon as I said that, you know, right out of the back of my mind, God whispers, yeah, I say that to you all the time. You know, I remember one of the first times it was so clear. You know, we had it with our one child, our oldest, you know, we'd make her a bottle and you know, as I'd try to, every time she'd see the bottle, she'd go crazy. She'd start crying. And so what I'd do is I'd start to make the bottle in secret and try to prepare it. But even then, she would see it, and she'd start just going crazy. So I'd start even doing a dance. You know, I'd be like, I'd do the dance, and I'd be in shake, 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 shake the baba. You know, I'm doing all this dance and trying to distract her, but she'd still cry. And I remember one day saying, when will you, you know, just out of frustration, she doesn't understand what I'm saying. She's less than a year old. But I said, you know, when will you ever realize that I'm not preparing this and putting it in front of you to take it away? I'm preparing it to give it to you. And God says, yeah, I wonder that all the time. It's true. That's the way it is. Now, if we understand our relationship with our children, then the principles that we understand should apply towards God's relationship with us. He doesn't love us any less. Now, one of the powerful principles that we have to learn is that when you look at that, you realize that the heart of a parent means that our heart is bound up with the heart and joy of our children. There's a sense that you think about that as a parent. You know, we can't be happy if our kids aren't happy, isn't it? I mean, think about that in our own lives. You know, I've seen people that have all kinds of blessings in life, and everything is going great, and their life is defined by wonderful things, but they struggle and they have pain, and you talk to them and they're struggling. Why? Because they see their children making self-destructive decisions, and because their children are struggling, they're suffering. On the other hand, I've seen people that are going through, you know, maybe some personal things that are challenging, but their kids are you know, thriving. And you talk about how you're doing, and they light up with joy because they have a joy because of their parents. Or, you know, we can even illustrate this on a smaller scale. You think about Christmas. I mean, we come to about Christmas, and those of, you know, we're parents, especially when we have younger kids, we go out and we go shopping, we save money all year, and we go shopping, we go to malls when they're busy. Who wants to be there? You know, it's like I'm sitting at a toy store once at 5 a.m. looking for a toy that I know my child really wants. I'm like, what in the world am I doing here for this? Why am I? Or you're sitting there late at night and you're putting, with the girls especially, they had these little castles that you had to put together. And it take hours to put together. And you're like, why are you doing this? Well, because I anticipated the joy of my children. And so I invest time and I invest money and I do all these things because I anticipate. I think about them being happy and I'm willing to invest all these things into their happiness. Now this is something that we can relate to as a parent, anybody who's been a parent. Now, but where does that come from? Where does that joy in the heart of a parent based on the joy of our children, where does that come from? See, again, our parenting is a copy of God's parenting for us. We're made in the image of God, and we're imperfect images of him. And what that means is that our heart for our children is an imperfect copy of God's heart for us. And in the same way, his heart is tied up into our joy. Let me give you an example of that. Matthew 7, again, later in the Sermon on the Mount, look what Jesus said. Which one of you, if his son asks him for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a serpent? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him? You hear the key words there? How much more will your Father give good things? You know, if you are loving, if you value the happiness of your children, do you think that God loves his children any less? It's something incredible. You see, there's no parent on earth that, you know, wanted joy for their children more than God wants joy for his children. How much more? But there are some differences between us and God. Number one, God is omniscient. You know, there are times that I might want to give something to my children. I might really believe that it's good, but I don't have the power. I don't have the resources. I can't give them all the things that I think that might be good for them. But number two is that God is totally selfless. And so when I think about my own children, you know what? Because I take joy in their joy, there are times out of selflessness I give them things that may not be for their benefit. You think of, you know, of Rybka Salt and their dad. You know, I want you to be happy. And what's he doing? Giving everything because he's trying to buy happiness. And there are times that I will give my children things that may not be best for them because I want to be happy in their joy. Or I will keep from holding things back from them that might make them, you know, sad or miserable because I want to protect them, even if that thing might be for their health in the long run. Not only that, but God is all-knowing. He knows what's best. There are times that I do what I think is right, but I'm wrong. I don't always make the best decisions for my kids because my perspective is limited, but God is unlimited in his perspective. He always knows what's right. Now, if we understand this, what you understand is that when you have a God who is our Father, who loves us this way, who takes joy in our joy, in our happiness, in our health, you see, can't we have confidence in that God, in that Father? So if we come to him, he wants us to have confidence, but then he also wants us to have trust. Trust in the wisdom of our Heavenly Father. So we not only know that he loves us, but we trust in his wisdom. You see, because we then often struggle with, well, if God's all powerful and he makes promises that he wants to give us, he wants me to be happy and he wants me to find joy, then why doesn't he give me the things that I ask for? See, what we have to, again, understand is that we have to see this in terms of parent-child relationship. The fact is, a lot of times we can come to God and we think not as a parent-child, then we come to him as our parent, our father, but we kind of come to God thinking that he's more like our genie. That we ask him for things, and if we ask him, what does a genie do? A genie always has to give you whatever you ask. If you rub the lamp the right way, he's always going to give you what you want. Now, does a father do that? No. A loving father doesn't always give. There's always, in a sense, a safety catch. A father is always asking not only what do you want, but what's best for you. Now, the thing is that children think they know what's best. They think they know what's going to be happy. They think they know what they need, but they don't. You know, could you imagine giving a five-year-old an Aladdin's lamp and all the things it asked for and the destruction that would be? I mean, that'd be the worst thing possible for them. Now, the thing is that, unfortunately, we often approach God like a genie. And we're not asking, our Father, I surrendered your wisdom. We're asking, God, genie, will you do these things because I know what's best? And we say, but we do. Well, what we've got to think about this is from this side. See, a five-year-old can't understand. Would you trust a five-year-old with the genie's lamp? Of course not. How about a 10-year-old? How about a 15-year-old? What about a 25-year-old? See, we might understand, well, 5 and 10 and 15, but at 25, well, now I understand. Now I can get it. Now I know things I didn't understand when I was 15. Now, but when you're 40, you look back and you say, man, 25, man, I was an idiot then, but now I understand. Now I'm 40. Now I understand. And then you're, 50, 55, you say, man, I was an idiot when I was 40. And you know what the Bible says? You're always an idiot. And that's, in a sense, what it is. The fact of the matter is that and before God, we're more like the five-year-old who thinks that we understand, who are confident in what we need, but God's sitting there saying, no, you don't. And he says, what you need to realize is that we're not coming to God genie, we're coming to God Father as a young child that says, God, I really don't know. And what we've got to realize is that God comes and says, as a good parent, what I'm going to do is I'm going to listen to what you really need. But this is what I need. And doesn't the Bible say that we're called to bring everything to him and he's going to answer our requests? Yeah, he does. But here's the difference. You see, a good father is able to distinguish between the child's need and their interpretation of how that need should be fulfilled. So you might look at that and you have, your kids come to you and say, Dad, I'm bored. Let's get some knives out and let's throw knives at each other. And here, you're going to say, no, that's a bad idea, right? But if you say you're bored, you say, okay, well, let's go find a good idea. I'm not going to give you the knives, but what we're going to do is let's go do a game. Let's go play football. Let's go do something that is productive, that's helpful. See, a parent always does that. A good parent doesn't respond to unwise requests, but they discern the underlying need. And here's what we have to realize. When we come to God, God always answers our prayer. But he looks and we're like that child that is asking for something and there's an underlying need and we think here's the way it should be. We were asking the specifics and God says, I'm going to listen to that underlying need and I'm going to understand, interpret, and see the things that you don't. You see, here's a principle that we need to remember. It's a great principle. God will always give you what you would have asked if you knew everything that he knows. Isn't that a great principle? And it's true. It's challenging for us to believe because we're the five-year-old thinking that we know. And he says, no, you don't know. And I hear your heart, and I want to give you what you need, and I'm going to give you what you would ask if you saw everything and understood everything that I understand. What a great principle. Do we have trust in that? See, when we do, it will lead us to that last point of what we need to understand. It's that prerequisite is we need to come and surrender the will of our Father. Because we will only do this if we have confidence in the love of the Father, if we trust the wisdom of the Father. Then we will come to God and we will come and say, here are my needs, here are my requests. But you realize that Jesus said before you get there, before you come to give us this day our daily bread, he said, first of all, we need to pray, God, your will be done. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. God, before I get to my needs, because I trust in your love, because I trust in your wisdom, God, I want to know what is your will. I want to acknowledge that what I think may not be right. I want to know your agenda for my family before I tell you my agenda. God, I want to know your agenda for my friendships, for my dating. God, I want to know your agenda for my job and my future. God, I want to know those things before I tell you my agenda. Because I realize that the goal of prayer isn't to somehow change God's mind, but it's to expose my heart, to allow God to somehow transform my heart. It's to change me in the context of relationship. Now let's end up then and say, okay, practically, how do we do this? What does this look like? How do we pray for our daily bread? Just some basic principles of putting this into practice. First of all, we need to acknowledge the daily need of our dependence. You see, the fact of the matter is, especially in America, we don't generally ask for daily provision. You know, I don't want to ask for, God, give me this day for my daily bread. I want a refrigerator full for the week and a bank account that's going to cover at least the next couple months. Right? I don't want daily. And daily is hard. Daily is really hard. We would love to have that most, you know, more generous provision. But God oftentimes will give us a daily bread. Now, here's what I want you to realize. What if your children, if you have children, young children, what if they said, okay, I want to make sure that I'm stashing up food in case you don't feed me tomorrow? Think about our young children. They live day by day in trust of the parent. And God, in the same way, at times will allow us to live in constant dependence. Because what he wants us to do is that he wants us to remember that we need things for him. So part of that is praying daily. It's praying, yes, before the meals, remembering, God, you give us these things. Help me to remember. That's why it's important and valuable to pray at meals, to remember that daily need and that daily provision. And daily to not only look for the food, but to look at all these things, to realize that there's nothing that I can do on my own, that everything is a daily gift of God's provision. I need to remember that. But then, too, this is something that we struggle to remember, but it's something that becomes more real in difficult times. And in those difficult times, that's when we need to appreciate God's daily provision, that we need to not only see our need, then we're aware of the need, but we need to see the provision. You see, because when we go through any times of crisis, whether it be financial, relational, physical, anything else, this prayer, give us this day our daily bread, becomes really important. Because what we're doing is that we're praying for daily provision. We're praying for, God, help me today. A passage that I think Bill has the same idea. I love this passage, Lamentations chapter 3. We sing this verse. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is his faithfulness. You know what I love about that? Here's what it's saying. This is the nature of God's provision. His mercies will always be there, and here's how he provides them. Every morning when you get up, there's going to be a new package. They're new every morning, and it's sufficient for that day. See, a lot of times what will happen is we'll go through periods of crisis, and we're saying, man, how do I deal with this long-term need? How do I deal with this cancer? How do I deal? I lost a job. I don't know how I'm going to pay for the bills next month, and God, help me to do. God, you know, what am I going to do in the struggle in the marriage? God, how? And we're overwhelmed by this. And the fact of the matter is we're looking at the long term and we have no idea how to deal with it. And God's saying, here's what I want you to do. At times like that, I want you to remember, God, give me today my daily bread. God, give me today the mercies that I need. And often at these times, God will not give us a year's provision or even a week's provision. He will give us a day-to-day provision. He will give us what we need for that day. He will give us what we need financially and relationally in every way. Now, these are things that God, I tell you, God's taught me through hard knocks. He's taught me this through experience. I think through the most difficult times that we've been through in life. And I'm struggling and I'm worrying and I'm just, you know, stressing out. And God would begin to teach me these ideas, you know, that every day. And you know what I realized? Is people would even ask me, how are you doing? And if I had this perspective and if I could look at it and say, as of today, if I look at today going backwards, God's met my every need. His mercies have been new every morning, and it's always been sufficient. God's taken care of me. And if as of today, I'm content. But if I start thinking about tomorrow, then I'm really stressed out because God's not meeting my need. He's not providing this need. He's not done this. And the thing is that I'm stressed out because I don't see how he's providing for tomorrow. I'm not praying, give me this day my daily bread. And sometimes he will bring all of us through these periods of time where we are stressed out because we do not see his provision, but we don't see his provision because we're looking long-term, we're not looking daily. And if we look at daily, if we stop and say, has God met your needs as of today? We'll come back and say, yeah, yes. Okay, well, give me this day the daily bread. Has his mercies been new every morning? Yes, they have. Sometimes you just gotta live day by day. And you got to trust that tomorrow, his mercies, a new package of mercy is going to be there and it's going to get you through tomorrow. God never fails. Great is his faithfulness. Thirdly, we need to embrace humility in our need of God's wisdom. And basically, this is how we pray the Lord's Prayer. It's basically everything that we've said before. It's remembering their prerequisites. It's remembering that the prayer is cumulative in nature. It's remembering that we cannot properly understand what it means to say, give me this day my daily bread, until I first of all said, our Father who's in heaven. Hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done. It's remembering that if we don't do that, we can make our needs our gods. And we can become overwhelmed, and we can become like little Rybka and demanding of God, and because we don't understand. What we need to realize is that we need to learn to trust him. We need to learn to trust in his love and compassion, that he really loves us, that he really cares about us, that he has wisdom that we don't see, that we need to believe the principle that we told you a minute ago, that God will always give you what you would have asked for if you knew everything that he knows. You know, that's hard to believe. That's hard to believe when it looks like God isn't answering the prayer. But you know what? The way that we can continue to find peace that passes understanding is to pray through that first section of the Lord's Prayer and claim these principles for ourselves. And lastly, we need to embrace a relationship of surrender and dependence with God. God says, give us this day our daily bread. He calls us to him daily in dependence on him, to recognize that we need him. That we need him, and at times God will put us in places where we are more aware, whether it's financial and we need the bread, or whether it's relational, whether it's emotional, whether it's a job, whatever it would be. There are times that he allows us to go through that crisis because he wants us to remember to look for him. At times, again, it's often the need that will drive us to God in prayer, but don't just focus on the need. He wants a relationship where we surrender and we say, God, I need you. I'm dependent upon you. He wants to get in touch with you. And ultimately for all of us, that started with the fact that he wanted a relationship with us, and our need was brokenness of life, that we couldn't fix our life, we couldn't undo our own sin, and he provided a way through Jesus Christ. See, it starts by saying, do you know that God wants a relationship with you? Do you have a relationship with him? Have you ever accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? If not, he invites you to do so today. He invites you to embrace him, that relationship, not based on what you do, not based on what you've done, not based on earning it or performing, but based on grace and accepting his free gift of grace. We accept that gift. And if you have, what you realize that, again, God not only wants us to come to him that way to start, the whole relationship is like that. And he will again and again and again bring us to a point where we're dependent, where we have need, where we're in crisis, not because he doesn't care about us, but because he does. And because he's reminding us that we will be healthiest, that our lives will be most successful when we align ourselves with him. And there are times that he will make us dependent because he wants us to see the need for that relationship, surrender to him, rely upon him. In that relationship of Father, our Father who is in heaven, I praise your name, hallowed be your name. We want his kingdom to come. We want his will to be done on earth as in our life as it is in heaven. And when we do that, we then can pray, give us this day our daily bread, meet our needs, and he does in a way that gives us a peace that passes understanding.